Welcome back to another episode of GAMER-0, where we spread that gaming tooth like a virus. I'm your host, T. Hill. You know the business. Today, we're going to be talking about Castlevania Lords of Shadow, the DLC, Resurrections. We're going to be talking about Lulzsec, and something about journalists. Got that in there. There's some other little bits I'm going to throw in there, but those are the main things. Starting off with Castlevania Lords of Shadow, Resurrections. You guys know I'm a huge, huge Castlevania Lords of Shadow. Big shout out to Mercury Steam and David Cox for doing a phenomenal job with the title. You guys know I'm a big fan of Riviera. It was the first DLC. I like playing as the vampire chick, and what's her name, Laura. I think that was her name. Phenomenal. That first one was great. It had some combat, different gameplay mechanics. Then they come out with Resurrection, and I had super high hopes. I'm still playing through it. And you're probably thinking, what do you mean you're still playing through it? It's not even that long. Yeah, issues aplenty. Black screens. Constantly. You'll be in the middle of a fight, and then everything will go black. You'll still get all the backdrop, all the little artifacts like your health gauges. That will still be there, but everything else goes black. Some weird, like, modeling issues. Like, I was playing and fighting the Forgotten One, and like part of the polygons made like this big weird dagger that flew out of him. I wish I would have recorded that on my hot pod to show people, but that was like a trip and a half. I had never seen anything like that. It goes into a topic we were talking about on the Gamers 411 about developers, and do they care about, you know, quality? Do they just release products? How long do they test? I mean, these issues, I'm sure I'm not the only one that's having them, and I should never even experience this. A quality product should not have issues like this. You should not have graphical problems. And I remember the first DLC that was provided had some graphical issues, but not this bad. This is on a totally different level where I had to fight the boss. I was playing it for like 3-4 hours because I kept dying because of a black screen. So that's horrible. And David Cox, you guys need to like put out a patch, some kind of update to fix these issues. I'm sure I'm not the only one. If I am, well then I apologize. But my PlayStation 3 is working in perfectly fine order. So moving along, Lulzsec. Yeah, they broke up. I say this because I think it's kind of comical that the shit they were talking and how they're going to be so aggressive about Sony and go after them and la la la. And then I guess they started pissing off their own underground hacker movement, who didn't take too kindly to the publicity, the fact that they're just wildly swinging out at everybody. Apparently a 17-year-old member of one of these, I can't remember the name, like total underground hacker movements, made it very clear that if they didn't stop, I guess he gave them 48 hours to get their act together, and if they didn't, he would like take action, and apparently he did. They kind of mocked him and played off, oh, he's 17 years old, what is he gonna do? Apparently he hacked them, took control of their site, and before they like went out, which just I saw the article just the other day, that they pretty much broke up. But before they did, they released tons of information from four users' account information and their passwords on forums, for like AT&T gaming sites, all over the place. It was, I guess, a massive amount of information, user information. I'm pretty sure that these people, since that kind of stuff, from what I understand, that's a federal offense, giving out somebody's personal information without their consent. So those guys are gonna get busted, and just like I said, and no one believed me, and all the hackers are like, they're never gonna get busted. We look at Anonymous, boom, they got busted. Look at the 19-year-old over in the UK, boom, he gets busted. All you guys who say, oh, you're hackers and you're not gonna get busted, I hate to tell you, that's bullshit. Because And like the last 4 or 5 months, well over 100 of these guys have gotten busted. Yes, there's lots of them, and there's going to be one popping up for, or two popping up for everyone that gets taken down. But it's a good example when you go to jail, and now you're not going to, like, there's not a special prison for you. You go with the rest of the people who are going to make you their bitch. Things to think about before you start deciding to hack. So, want to put that out there. So, moving on to my last subject, and I don't want to take too much time with this, but I have noticed this for some time now across big sites like Game Trailers. Smaller sites, I've seen this. And I want to know what you guys think, because this is really important. As a journalist, I mean, you guys see me. I put my name out there. I got no problem putting my face behind what I say or what I review or how I feel about a subject. But I've seen a trend that a lot of sites, and I'm just beating up Game Trailers right now. It's nothing really against them. It's just, I noticed this and I've seen the comments. I've even heard it on like Invisible Walls, that they didn't, certain people didn't review the games and that they're going after them. And this is my thing. If you review something, or even if you write an article or an opinion piece, your name should be attached to it, and there should be a connect option. So that way, if I want to contact you to challenge your beliefs on what you're saying, as a consumer or as another journalist, we should have that ability to do so. Because that kind of anonymous review means that you're doing it for shock factor, and you don't stand behind what you say. It's more of, look at me, I want hits on my site, and less of, this is actually a quality review that can be, you know, addressed on a critical fashion. And I got a big issue with this, because what it allows these sites to do is kind of play the, well, I didn't review that, he reviewed that, no, I didn't review that, who reviewed that? To me, it's kind of BS. I think it's really cheap, it's really underhanded, and what it does is they can play the no one knew who reviewed it, and there's, you can't really target anyone and say, hey dude, challenging you on your beliefs, I'm challenging on the statements you made, the argument you put forth. And I don't want this to become a trend, because what that does is it's like the faceless kind of argument, well, this game sucks or this game's great, based on a website. It becomes more of a website review instead of a person's review. You can't follow their journalistic skills or faults, their career, because you don't know who really reviewed that game or put out that opinion piece. I mean, there's so much trash on the website, on websites in general, about just hits, flame bait hits, and less substance and real quality material. So I found this interesting that over the last like 6-7 months, I've seen this like becoming more of a common trend, and I really don't like it. It to me, I feel it's a disservice to, you know, the people playing the games, the people who are actually making the games, and the other journalists who want to follow up on their peers' works. I mean, take some pride, stand behind what you have to say. I mean, you guys may not always agree with me, but at least I put my face out there, and you can see who I am and see how I feel about what. Feel my passion and my conviction for my arguments. So that's the main thing I just want to put out there. I want to know what you guys think. Do you like that anonymous kind of review, that anonymous kind of editorial pieces or opinion pieces where they could take jabs in the dark at anyone, and you can't really, all you can do is fault the site for letting them go up without a name? Or do you even care? Another little piece is, do gamers, even do a massive amount of gamers actually even read what's on the internet? Do they know who's writing the reviews? Do they know who's even making the games? And I say this one little piece, and I don't want to get off on a tangent with it, but after coming at E3 and seeing all these amazing people like Michael Pachter, Stig Asmussen, David Jaffe, Ed Boon, Reggie Fils-Aimé, you see them walking around. I mean, this is just Nolan North, Amy Hennigan. I mean, the wonderful people over at Naughty Dog, Dylan Joe from Lightbox. I mean, you see them walking around the show floor. And these guys are celebrities. I mean, they're rock stars in the gaming industry. And consumers who paid their tickets, and even journalists, aren't going up to them and saying, oh my God, can I get your autograph? Can I do an interview? Can I shake your hand? It was none of that. And it made me think, one little kind of sidetrack piece is, do people even know anything about the games that they're playing? Do they complain but not know anything about it? I consider myself an educated consumer who knows the lineage of a developer that produces a product that I purchase, instead of just aimlessly purchasing whatever's out there. I have this thought in the back of my head that the average consumer does not do that. And to me, that's a problem. And if it propagates and becomes more commonplace, you're gonna have more cookie cutter type of games, because no one challenges those developers. They don't know who they are. You see them in the public and you don't say anything, you don't know who they are. And it's not like these guys are kind of hidden in the background. Everybody knows who Ed Boon is, or Ono from Street Fighter. David Jaffe. These are iconic people in our industry. And I seen them walking around and no one was running up like, oh snaps, that's Amy Hennigan, or oh snaps, that's Noel North, he did the voice of X or B or C, or countless. Noel North is everywhere, but does the average consumer even know this? Do they care about who's writing the reviews? Do they care about the people who are making the games? These are questions for the average consumer. What do you guys think? As always, leave your comments below. Let me know what you think. Curious to hear what you guys have to say, because this is important topics that a lot of people don't really get into. Bleach, Soul Ignition coming around the corner. I'm super pumped. That game's, I'm a big Bleach fan. I like to see maybe CyberConnect 2 would be cool if they, and I know these guys aren't the guy, it was Sony who did Bleach. I personally would like to see CyberConnect 2 work on Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood game. That would be hot. So let me know what you guys think. As always, you can follow me on hiphopgamershow.com. On Twitter, it's T_Hill0. Or if you want to game with me online, it's T-Hill. All right, I'm out. Peace.